In 2018, New York Times bestselling author N.K. Jemisin became the first author to win 3 Best Novel Hugo Awards in a row for her Broken Earth trilogy. She also has won a Nebula Award, 2 Locus Awards, and countless other honors that I would be here all night if I went into. Following her celebrated story collection, How Long Till Black Future Month, now comes The City We Became, the first in a new trilogy that asks the question, what if a city had a soul? In an NPR review of the book, Steve Mullis wrote, N.K. Jemisin is crushing it. This book is a love letter, a celebration, and an expression of hope and belief that a city and its people can and will stand up to darkness, will stand up to fear, and will, when called to, stand up for each other. And I think there is nothing more timely than a book like that. So without further ado, it is my pleasure to bring N.K. Jemisin onto your screens and into your homes.
Hi there. Thank you for that introduction. And welcome, folks from Politics and Prose. I hope that you are weathering the situation pretty well. So I'm going to be reading to you from The City We Became. Those of you that already have a copy of the hardcover, just a quick thing I want to remind you of. If you download Google Lens and look at this little thing, look at the front and back of the cover with it, you'll see that Orbit added some cool augmented reality things to the cover. So I've been enjoying the heck out of that all day. And I'm going to start with chapter 1. I will not be able to get through the whole of chapter 1 because it is super long. But hopefully I can stop on a good cliffhanger. So, all right. So let's get right to it. Chapter 1, starting with Manhattan and the Battle of FDR Drive. He forgets his own name somewhere in the tunnel to Penn Station. He doesn't notice at first. Too busy with all the stuff people usually do when they're about to reach their train stop, cleaning up the pretzel bags and plastic bottles of breakfast, stuffing his loose laptop power cord into a pocket of his messenger bag, making sure he's gotten his suitcase down from the rack, then having a momentary panic attack before remembering that he's only got one suitcase. The other was shipped ahead and will be waiting for him at his apartment up in Inwood, where his roommate already is, having arrived a few weeks before. They're both going to be grad students he's forgotten his school's name. Anyway, orientation is on Thursday, which gives him 5 days to get settled into his new life in New York. He's really going to need those days too, sounds like. As the train slows to a halt, people are murmuring and whispering, appearing intently at their phones and tablets with worried looks on their faces. Something about a bridge accident, terrorism, just like 9/11? He'll be living and working uptown, so it shouldn't impact him too much, but still, it's maybe not the best time to move here. But when is it ever a good time to make a new life in New York City? He'll cope. He'll more than cope. The train stops and he's first through the door. He's excited, but trying to play it cool. In the city, he will be completely on his own, free to sink or swim. He has colleagues and family members who think of this as exile, abandonment, although in the flurry of the moment, he cannot remember any of those people's names or faces, but that doesn't matter because they can't understand. They know him as he was and maybe who he is now. New York is his future. It's hot on the platform and crowded on the escalator, but he feels fine. Which is why it's so weird when he reaches the top of the escalator and suddenly, the instant his foot touches the polished concrete flooring, the whole world inverts. Everything in his vision seems to tilt, and the ugly ceiling fluorescence turns stark, and the floor kind of heaves. It happens fast. The world pulls inside out, and his stomach drops, and his ears fill with a titanic, many-voiced roar. It's a familiar sound to a degree. Anyone who's been to a stadium during a big game has heard something similar. Madison Square Garden sits on top of Penn Station, so maybe that's it. This sound is bigger, though. Millions of people instead of thousands, and all of those voices doubled back on each other and swelling and shifting into layers beyond sound, into color and shaking and emotion, until he claps his hands over his ears and shuts his eyes, but it just keeps coming. But amid all of the cacophony, there is a through line, a repeated motif of sound and word and idea, one voice screaming fury. Fuck you, you don't belong here, this city is mine, get out! And the young man wonders in confused horror, me? Am I the one that doesn't belong? There is no answer, and the doubt within him becomes an unignorable backbeat of its own. All at once, the roar is gone. A new roar, closer and echoing and indescribably smaller, has replaced it. Some of it is recorded, blaring from PA speakers overhead. New Jersey transit train southbound, stopping at Newark Airport, now boarding on track 5. The rest is the sound of a gigantic space full of people going about their business. He remembers then as it resolves around him, Penn Station. He does not remember how he ended up on one knee beneath a train schedule sign with a shaking hand plastered over his face. Wasn't he on an escalator? He also doesn't remember ever before seeing the two people who are crouched in front of him. He frowns at them. Did you just tell me to get out of the city? No, I said. Do you want me to call 911? Says the woman. She's offering water. She looks more skeptical than worried, like maybe he's faking whatever weird faint or fit that's apparently made him fall over in the middle of Penn Station. No. He shakes his head, trying to focus. Neither water nor the police will fix weird voices in his head or hallucinations caused by train exhaust or whatever he's experiencing. What happened? You just kind of went sideways, says the man bent over him. He's a portly, middle-aged, pale-skinned Latino. Heavy New York accent, kindly tone. We caught you and pulled you over here. Oh, everything's still weird. The world isn't spinning anymore, but that terrible layered roar is still in his head, just muted now and overlaid by the local and perpetual cacophony that is Penn Station. I think I'm fine? Yeah, you don't sound too sure, the man says. That's because he's not. He shakes his head, then shakes it again when the woman pushes the water bottle forward. I just had some on the train. Low blood sugar, maybe. She takes the water bottle away and looks thoughtful. There's a little girl crouched beside her, he notices belatedly, and the two of them are nearly mirrors of each other, both black-haired, freckled, frank-faced Asian people. When was the last time you ate? Like 20 minutes ago? He doesn't feel dizzy or weak, either. He feels new, he murmurs, without thinking. I feel new. The portly man and frank-faced woman look at each other, while the little girl throws him a judgy look, complete with lifted eyebrow. Are you new here? Asks the portly man. Yeah? Oh, no. My bags! But they're right there. The Good Samaritans have kindly pulled them off the escalator, too, and positioned them nearby out of the flow of traffic. There's a kind of surreality to the moment as he finally realizes he's having this blackout or delusion or whatever it is in the middle of a crowd of thousands. Nobody seems to notice except these three people. He feels alone in the city. He is seen and cared for in the city. The contrast is going to take some getting used to. You must have gotten your hands on some of the really good drugs, the woman says. She's grinning, though. That's okay, isn't it? That's what'll keep her from calling 911. He remembers reading somewhere that New York's got an involuntary commitment law that can hold people for weeks, so it's probably a good idea to reassure his would-be rescuers as to his clarity of mind. Sorry about this, he says, pushing to his feet. Maybe I didn't eat enough or something. I'll go to an urgent care clinic. Then it happens again. The station lurches beneath his feet, and suddenly it is in ruins. There's no one around. A cardboard book display in front of the convenience store has fallen over, spilling Stephen King hardcovers everywhere. He hears girders and the surrounding structure groan, dust and pebbles falling to the floor as something in the ceiling cracks. The fluorescent lights flicker and jerk, one of the overhead fixtures threatening to fall from the ceiling. He inhales to cry a warning. Blink. Everything is fine again. None of the people around him react. He stares at the ceiling for a moment, then back at the man and woman. They are still staring at him. They saw him react to whatever he was seeing, but they did not see the ruined station themselves. The portly guy has a hand on his arm because he apparently swayed a little. Psychotic breaks must be hell on inner ear imbalance. You want to carry bananas, the portly guy suggests. Potassium, good for you. Or at least some real food, the woman agrees, nodding. You probably just ate chips, right? I don't like that overpriced crap from the train dining car either, but at least it'll keep you from falling over. I like the hot dogs, the little girl says. They're crap, baby, but I'm glad you like them. She takes the little girl's hand. We've got to go. You good? Yeah, he says. But seriously, thanks for helping me. You hear all kinds of stuff about how rude New Yorkers are, but thanks. Nah, we're only assholes to people who are assholes first, she says. But she smiles as she says it. Then she and the little girl wander off. The portly man claps him on the shoulder. Well, you don't look like you're gonna chuck. Want me to get you something to eat or some juice or something? Or a banana? He adds the latter pointedly. No thanks. I'm feeling better, really. The portly man looks skeptical, then blinks as something new occurs to him. It's okay, you know, if you don't got money. I'll spot you. Oh no, I'm good. He hefts his messenger bag, which he remembers costing almost $1,600. Portly guy looks at it blankly. Whoops. There's probably sugar in this. There's a plastic Starbucks tumbler in the bag, sloshing faintly. He drinks from it to reassure portly guy. The coffee is cold and disgusting. He belatedly remembers refilling it sometime yesterday before he got on the train back home in... That's when he realizes he can't remember where he came from. And he tries, but he still can't remember the school he's here to attend. And this is when it finally hits him that he doesn't know his own name. As he sits there, floored by this triple epiphany of nothingness, the portly guy is turning up his nose at the tumbler. Get some real coffee while you're here, he says. From a good Boricua shop, yeah? Excuse me. Get some home food while you're at it. Anyway, what's your name? He rubs his neck and pretends to have a desperate need to stretch while, quietly panicking, he looks around and tries to think of something. He can't believe this is happening. Who the hell forgets their own name? All he can come up with as fake names go are generic ones like Bob or Jimmy. He's about to say Jimmy arbitrarily, but then, in his visual flailing, his eyes snag on something. I'm Manny, he blurts. You? Douglas. Portly guy has his hands on his hips, obviously considering something. Finally, he pulls out his wallet and hands over a business card. Douglas Acevedo, plumber. Oh, sorry, I don't have a card. Haven't started my new job yet. It's okay, Douglas says. He still looks thoughtful. Look, a lot of us were new here once. You need anything, you let me know, okay? Seriously, it's fine. Place to crash, good food, a good church, whatever. It's unbelievably kind. Manny doesn't bother to hide his surprise. Wow, man. You don't know me from Adam. I could be a serial killer or something. Douglas chuckles. Yeah, somehow I'm not figuring you for the violent type. You look... He falters, and then his expression softens a little. You look like my son. I'm just doing for you what I'd want somebody doing for him, right? Somehow Manny knows Douglas's son is dead. Right, Manny says softly. Thanks again. Está bien, mano. No te preocupes. Sorry, my Spanish is not good. He wanders off then heads in the direction of the ACE train. Manny watches him go, pocketing the card and thinking about three things. The first is the belated realization that the guy thought he was Puerto Rican. The second is the realization that he might have to take Douglas up on that offer of a place to crash, especially if he doesn't remember the address of his apartment in the next few minutes. The third thing makes him look up at the arrivals and departures board, where he found the word that just became his new name. He doesn't tell Douglas the full name because these days only white women can have given names like that without getting laughed at. But even in modified form, this word, this identity, feels more true than anything else he's ever claimed in his life. It is what he has been without realizing. It is who he is. It is everything he's ever needed to be. The full word is Manhattan. In the bathroom, under the sodium lights, he meets himself for the first time. It's a good face. He pretends to be extra meticulous about washing his hands. Not a bad thing to be in a smelly Penn Station public bathroom. And turns his face from side to side, checking himself out from all angles. It's clear why the dude figured him for Puerto Rican. His skin is yellowy brown, his hair kinky but loose coiled enough that if he let it grow out, it might dangle. He could pass for Douglas's son, maybe. He's not Puerto Rican, though. He remembers that much. He's dressed preppy, in khakis, a button-down with rolled-up sleeves, and there's a sports jacket draped over his bag for when the AC is too high, maybe, since it's summertime and probably 90 degrees outside. He looks like he's somewhere in that ageless yawn between not a kid anymore and 30, although probably toward the latter end of it to judge by a couple of random gray threads peppered along his hairline. Brown eyes behind dark brown rimmed glasses. The glasses make him look professorial. Sharp cheekbones, strong, even features, smile lines developing around his mouth. He's a good-looking guy. Generic all-American boy, non-white version, nicely nondescript. Convenient, he thinks. Wondering why he thinks this makes him pause in mid-hand wash, frowning. Okay, no. He's got enough weirdness to deal with right now. He grabs his suitcase to leave the bathroom. An older guy at the urinal stares at him all the way out. At the top of the next escalator, this one leading up to 7th Avenue, it happens a third time. This episode is better in some ways and worse in others, because Manny feels a wave of whatever it is coming on as he reaches the top of the escalator. He has enough time to take his suitcase and get himself over to some kind of digital information kiosk, so he'll be out of the way while he leans against it and shudders. This time, he doesn't hallucinate, not at first, but he hurts all of a sudden. It's an awful, sick feeling, a spreading chill starting from a point low on his left flank. The sensation is familiar. He remembers it from the last time he got stabbed. Wait, he got stabbed? Frantically, he pulls up his shirt tail and looks at the place where the pain is worst, but there's no blood. There's nothing. The wound is all in his head or somewhere else. As if this is a summons, abruptly the New York that everyone sees flickers into the New York that only he can see. Actually, they're both present, one lightly superpositioned over the other, and they flick back and forth a little before finally settling into a peculiar dual boot of reality. Before Manny lie two 7th Avenues. They're easy to distinguish because they have different palettes and moods. In one, there are hundreds of people within view and dozens of cars and at least six chain stores that he recognizes. Normal New York. In the other, there are no people and some unfathomable disaster has taken place. He doesn't see bodies or anything ominous. There's just no one around. It's not clear anyone ever existed in this place. Maybe the buildings here just appeared, sprung forth, fully formed from their foundations instead of being built. Ditto the streets, which are empty and badly cracked. A traffic light dangles loose from an overhead fixture, swinging on its cable, but switching from red to green in perfect tandem with its other version. The sky is dimmer, almost as if it's nearly sunset and not just post-noon, and the wind is faster. Clouds boil and churn across the sky like they're late for the cloud revival meeting. Cool, Manny murmurs. This whole episode probably represents some kind of psychotic break on his part, but he cannot deny that what he sees is gorgeous and terrifying. Weird New York. He likes it, regardless. But something is wrong with it. He must go somewhere, do something, or all of the bifurcated beauty that he sees will die. He knows this suddenly, more surely than instinct. I have to go, he murmurs to himself in surprise. His voice sounds strange, tinny and sort of stretched out. Maybe he's slurring? Maybe it's the peculiar echo of his voice from the walls of two different Penn Station entryway walls in two different Penn Stations. Hey, says a guy in a neon green button-down nearby. Manny blinks at him. Normal New York abruptly resumes, weird New York vanishing for the moment. It's still there somewhere nearby. The button-down is part of a uniform. The guy is carrying a sign hawking bike rentals at tourists. He faces Manny with open hostility. Puke your drunk ass off somewhere else. Manny tries to straighten, but he knows he's still a little diagonal. I'm not drunk. He's just seeing juxtaposed multiple realities while being plagued by inexplicable compulsions and phantom sensations. Well, then take your high ass somewhere else. Yes, that's a good idea. He needs to go east. He turns in that direction, following instincts he never had before a few minutes ago. What's that away? He asks bike guy. My left nut, bike guy says. That's south, laughs another bike rental hawker nearby. Bike guy rolls his eyes and grabs his crotch at her in the iconic New York sign language gesture of suck my dick. The attitude's starting to grate. Manny says, if I rent a bike, will you tell me what's in that direction? Bike guy suddenly all smiles. Sure. No, sir, says bike woman, serious now as she comes over. Sir, I'm sorry, but we cannot rent a bike to someone who appears to be intoxicated or ill. Company policy. Do you need me to call 911? People in New York sure like to call 911. No, I can walk. I need to get to FDR Drive. FDR Drive. The woman's expression turns skeptical. You want to walk to FDR Drive? The hell kind of tourist are you, sir? He ain't no tourist, says he of the southern left nut, as he chin points at Manny. Look at him. Manny's never been to New York before, at least as far as he knows. I just need to get there, fast. Take a cab, then, says the woman. Taxi stands right there. Need me to grab one for you? Excuse me. Manny shivers a little, feeling the rise of something new within himself. Not sickness this time, or rather, not just sickness, since that terrible stabbish ache hasn't faded. What comes instead is a shift in perception. Beneath his... Ow, bit my tongue. Oh, gosh. Wow, got it good. All right, back to the reading, sorry. Beneath his hand, which rests on the kiosk, he hears a soft rattle of decades worth of flyers. The kiosk has nothing on it. There's a sign, do not post bills. He hears what used to be there. Traffic's flying past on 7th, hurrying to get through the light before a million pedestrians start trying to go to Macy's or K-Town Karaoke and Barbecue. All these things belong. They are a rightness. But his eyes stutter over a TGI Fridays and he twitches a little, lip curling in involuntary distaste. Something about its facade feels foreign, intrusive, jarring. A tiny, cluttered shoe repair shop next to it does not elicit the same feeling, nor does the vape shop next door. Just the chain stores that Manny sees, a Foot Locker, a Sbarro, all the sorts of stores one normally finds at a low-end suburban mall. Except these mall stores are here, in the heart of Manhattan, and their presence is not truly harmful, but irritating. Like paper cuts, or little quick slaps to the face. The subway sign, though, feels right and real. The billboards, too, no matter what's on them. The cabs and the flow of cars and people, all these things soothe the irritants somehow. He draws in a deep breath that reeks of hot garbage and acrid steam belching from a manhole cover nearby, and it's foul, but it's right. More than right. Suddenly, he's better. The sick feeling recedes a little, and his side dulls from stabbing pain into cold prickles that only hurt when he moves. Thanks, he says to bike woman, straightening and grabbing his roller bag. But my ride's coming. Wait, how does he know that? The woman shrugs. Both of them turn away to resume hawking bikes. Manny walks toward the area where people are waiting for lifts or Ubers. He has both apps on his phone, but he hasn't used them. There should be nothing here for him. However, a moment later, a cab rolls to a stop right in front of him. It's like a cab out of an old movie, smooth and bulbous and huge, with a black and white checkered strip along its near flank. Bike guy does a double take, then whistles. A checker! Haven't seen one of those since I was a kid. It's for me, Manny says unnecessarily, and reaches for the door. It's locked. I need this open, he thinks. The door lock clicks open. So that's new, but he'll process it later. All right, I'm going to stop there. All right, so that's it for the reading. I hope you guys enjoyed. That was from chapter one of The City We Became. I have not yet listened to the audiobook version of The City We Became, which is read by Robin Miles. I'm sure she did a much better job than me because she's an amazing actress. But that said, I hope that I did somewhat well. All right, so now let's start looking at the questions. So next question is, how do you think about your legacy fitting into the very racist, very sexist history of the genre? Obviously, there are, I'm always like fascinated by Alex Trebek saying genre. Okay, I think I said that right. Anyway, obviously, there are amazing voices in speculative fiction's pantheon. But the dominant ones tend to include narratives that are destructive and inequitable. Yours tend not to. How do you deal with, for example, Orson Scott Card, whose influence can't be denied, but whose bigotry, racism, sexism, homophobia, etc., can also not be denied? I'm not sure what you mean by how do I deal with it. I came into this genre as a child. I slowly started reading my way through the classics or the canon that everybody recommended to me. At first, I did not understand the problem. And then as I grew older and more mature, I began to realize, oh yeah, a lot of these motherfuckers are racist. And some other ists. And they are part of the canon. A lot of my writing is in conversation with that canon. And so therefore, I feel the need to address it directly. I don't believe that, you know, people should not read these things. Obviously there's some Lovecraftian influence, for example, in The City We Became. And you're not going to fully get that influence if you haven't actually read some Lovecraft. Now that said, you don't have to read Lovecraft to fully enjoy it. It's just that, like, you need to understand that that's who I'm in conversation with. And Lovecraft, if you don't know, was ginormously racist, ginormously everythingist, anti-Semitic, even though he was married to a Jewish woman. The man hated, like, the Portuguese. I don't even really fully understand why. Anyway. So you don't have to read those classics, unless you are planning to engage with the multiple layers of meaning that they have exerted upon the genre. I think there are enough new and good classics out there that you can skip them if you want. But in my case, I've chosen to engage with them and speak back to them through my writing. So that works for me. I hope that answers the question. All right, next question. Do you ever get to a point in your writing editing when you're just sick of looking at a piece of work? If so, what do you do then? Yes, this is perfectly normal. In fact, a few years ago for NaNoWriMo, I wrote an article called The Chasm of Doubt, where I talked about this being a normal process that writers go through. And I was talking about the fact that when you start writing something, you're kind of on an emotional high, because in order to commit yourself to writing a whole novel, you have to think it's the greatest thing since sliced bread. You gotta feel like really good about it. But the process of writing is not romantic. It is not glamorous. It is not constantly fun. And inevitably, as you begin the process of writing, your mood is gonna dip. And it's going to end up getting at some point pretty low. And yeah, you will be sick of looking at your work. You will want to delete it. You will want to fire it into the sun. When I was in the middle of working on the Broken Earth series, the fifth season, I had one of those chasms of doubt that was like epic, the biggest I've ever had. And friends of mine staged an intervention where they dragged me to brunch and, over biscuits, we had a deep conversation about the fact, no, Nora, you cannot delete your novel. So yeah, that's a perfectly normal thing to do. What fixes it is finishing the book and then starting the process of revisions, at least for me. Revisions start to pull you back up towards, oh wait, this actually does feel good. This is actually the vision that I had when I first started writing this thing. So get through revisions and then you will love it again. I hope that helps. Okay, so next question. I'm really enjoying the book. I'm only a few chapters in. Excuse me, I should read people's names, shouldn't I? Next question is from Carrie. I'm really enjoying the book. I'm only a few chapters in, but I'm getting very American Gods vibe. What inspired you to base this in New York City? The fact that I live in New York City, mostly. But I was also kind of speaking to the fact that just as I was speaking with the DC question a little while ago, excuse me, whenever you move to a new place, whenever anybody moves to a new place, this is not a thing that I am the only one that feels, I'm pretty sure. When I move into a new city or visit a new city, I often feel like an instantaneous sense of either, you know, this place, its personality is congruent with mine. You know, we would get along. I like the city and it likes me. We might be able to live together. You know, it's almost like the moment of attraction that you feel when you meet a potential partner, or that I feel, not everybody does, I know. But that said, and I did not feel that like with DC, for example, but I did feel it with New York. I felt it with New Orleans. I felt it with Tokyo when I visited there once many years ago. I felt it with San Francisco, although that was many, many years ago before like the current gentrification is kind of like stripped a lot of the city of what it used to be. And so, you know, and a lot of people feel this. So I just wanted to kind of articulate that, because to me, that is energy. That is a sense of the city's personality. You know, it's not speculative to me that cities have souls. So I wanted to try and encapsulate that. And see what I could do with it. So, you know, many of you have probably felt something similar. Boston did not like me. Personality was not congruent with mine, but I lived there for 8 years trying to make it work. And, you know, maybe I should have given up on that relationship sooner. But yeah, so that's basically what I was trying to speak to. Let's see. In the Broken Earth trilogy, the origins really are dangerous. Is the fear towards an inherently dangerous minority justified? How does that impact what you would like your writing to say about minorities when you do world building? Excellent question from Meredith. I was deliberately playing with a concept when I decided to make the oppressed group actually dangerous. Because around the time that I was kind of working on this was when like Ferguson was happening. Those of you who remember all the stuff that was happening with Ferguson, with Michael Brown, may remember that during the trial, Darren, whatever the fuck his name was, the cop who shot Michael Brown, described him as superhuman, you know, described him as like a Hulk, and shot him multiple times, because he felt that one bullet would not be enough. So, you know, what I was kind of trying to engage with is the fact that, you know, Black people are not superhuman, but people react to us as if we are. And that's terrible. You know, there are those who think that it's somehow a compliment to say that Black women are strong. Well, but that treats us like we're not human. And like we don't have moments of vulnerability and pain and suffering. There are doctors who genuinely believe that Black people and other people of color cannot feel pain to the same degree that white people do. And they under-medicate people who are chronic pain sufferers or acute pain sufferers. So, you know, that's what I was kind of engaging with. It doesn't matter whether we genuinely are dangerous if people are reacting to us as if we are. And so therefore, it doesn't matter if Hitler came up with the idea that Jewish people were somehow involved in this massive cabal conspiracy, whatever, and then use that as justification for the Holocaust. Because and it doesn't matter that they were just ordinary people trying to live their lives. He still killed them. And so this is the thing. If you are engaging with oppression, you have to engage with not just the reality, but the appearance, and the myths that are spun, to justify oppression. And that's really what I wanted to kind of get at. Slight spoiler for the Broken Earth series. It does become clear later on in the series that the orogenes are dangerous, but only when you take them out of context. When you raise orogene children, for example, away from their parents, who have the ability to kind of stop them from doing whatever dangerous stuff that they could do, when you take them out of, in this completely unnatural way, out of the family settings that they're supposed to be in, of course they're dangerous. Everybody's dangerous when you take them out of context, or when you take them away from the systems and the support networks that they need. And so that's really kind of what I was trying to get at. That's a complex answer, and I'm realizing that I have talked too long on this one, so let's move on so I can try and get all of them. But I hope that answered your question.